All right, testing, testing, testing. We are going to, I know we have folks still coming in, and that's fine, but we want to go ahead and get things kicked off right on time because we don't want to take 1 minute away from what Andy has to share. And we are going to also afterwards have out in the lobby some cookies and punch and coffee and I don't know what all, but things to eat, surprise, surprise, for us out there. And then Andy will also, at that time, he'll be available to talk further to any of you in here or out there, however it best works. But we're going to try to shut down formally at 8:15. And then, again, you can stay as long as you'd like, and we'll go from there. I'm going to open us in prayer, and then I'm going to introduce Andy and give him the full amount of time we possibly can. But let's pray, and we'll begin. Heavenly Father, we thank you for who you are, and we thank you for who Scripture says that you are. We thank you that Scripture is enough. It's the final revelation, and we can know in holding our Bible that we have the truth. Lord, and we thank you for Andy coming and sharing with us tonight. And we thank you that we have all turned out to hear and to learn and to grow in this important area of our faith. And Lord, I just pray you'd be with him and give him the words to say. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are in our third session on the Different series. We have dealt so far with Jehovah Witnesses. We dealt last month with Islam or Mormonism. I mean, in Muslims. Fast forward, here we are. Tonight, we are dealing with the difference, and that's really the way we're approaching this, the difference between evangelical Christianity, which is what we are and how we believe, and Mormonism. And so I'm going to introduce Andy and then have him come up. But basically, he was in Mormonism formally for 30 years, served a mission. I didn't ask him what age, but I'm guessing probably in the range of 20 years old or so to Columbus, Ohio. Was sealed and married in the Mesa Temple to his wife, Lori. And they are still married today, and I'm sure he'll tell us about that. Been out of the Mormon church for 8.5 years, and the general manager of Concerned Christians down in the Mesa area for the past 3 years. He and his wife have 5 children. Tyler is 15 going on 16, or is that 15 going on 25? I didn't ask you. Jacob is 14. Luke is 12. Michael, 11. And then Elena is 9. And I appreciate Andy and his place in life in that he had a hard time remembering the ages of his kids. It brought back memories that still are difficult for me. So Andy, with no further ado, Andy Poland is going to come speak to us tonight. Let's give him a Mountain Bible welcome.
I'm very grateful to be here tonight, and I'm grateful that Jim asked me to come and to speak on Mormonism. Wow, we got a great crowd. I want to be clear tonight because I don't want to come off like I'm bashing Mormons because that's not what I'm here to do. I love my family, and most of them are still Mormon. And so what I'm here to do is just to explain the hope that I have in Christ, the differences between what Mormonism, I used to worship as a Mormon, versus what I worship now, so that you can have an understanding. And this is not to belittle the Mormon people or to give you a gotcha, something that you can go up to your Mormon friends and neighbors and say, I gotcha. You know, that's not what this is about. This is about learning how to understand what their beliefs are so that you can present the gospel to them. And the gospel, really simple, is not that Joseph Smith is a false prophet. That is not the gospel. The gospel is that Jesus is God, and that if you believe in him right now, you have eternal life. And so that is what we should be proclaiming, not that Joseph Smith is a false prophet. So I want to start off by sharing my story about how I came out of Mormonism. My story is kind of a mess from any standard, but it's mine, and God gave it to me, and I'm very glad that He saved me. But the best way that you can understand me is to understand that when I was about 14 years old, I went to a youth conference. I actually grew up in Cottonwood, Arizona, not too far from here, and so coming up here is really a treat for me because it's not too far from home. And our stake went up to Brigham Young University with a youth group, and one of the speakers got up and said, you know, if you do not have a testimony to know if Joseph Smith was a prophet, then you need to get one. Now, to help you understand, a Mormon testimony means that you've prayed and you've asked God to know if Joseph Smith was a prophet, and you've had God give you an answer through a good, peaceful feeling. Sometimes they describe that as a burning in the bosom. And so I decided that night that I really wanted to do that. And so I went home to the dorm room and I read a few passages from the Book of Mormon, and I knelt down on my knees and I prayed and I asked God if Joseph Smith was a prophet. And I had this really good, peaceful feeling that overcame me, and I believe that God told me through that experience that Joseph Smith was a prophet. And from that experience, I based everything that I did from that point on, from believing that God had told me that Joseph Smith was a prophet. And so I started preparing for my mission, which I knew I would go when I turned 19 years old. And I started paying attention in church and at seminary and doing everything that a good Mormon is supposed to do. Now, one year we were in the seminary, we were studying the Doctrine and Covenants. And we got to section 132 in the Doctrine and Covenants, and it talks about how Joseph Smith was revealed to him that he needed to practice polygamy. And I was concerned about polygamy because I knew that the church was not practicing polygamy. And it kind of bothered me that Joseph Smith was told to practice polygamy. And I thought, you know what? I prayed to know if Joseph Smith was a prophet, and I can also pray about polygamy to find out if it really was from God, and that should clear everything up. And so I decided to pray about it, and I prayed and I asked God if Joseph Smith had really received that revelation. And I had this really good, peaceful feeling that overcame me, and a thought that came to my mind that said, Andy, yes, he did receive that. I gave that to him to practice, and one day you will practice polygamy as well. Now, that was a little bit more information than I wanted to hear at that moment. And I was kind of like, well, you know, that's really strange because the church isn't practicing polygamy right now. And so how could this be? And I thought, oh, well, wait a minute. I've been taught also that when Christ returns during the millennial period, that polygamy will be brought back. And so I've also been told that I would live during the millennial period in my patriarchal blessing. And so I thought, I'll be practicing polygamy during the millennium. And so I just kind of put that on a shelf and forgot about it. Time came for my papers to be put in, and when I turned 19 years old, and I put them in, and I got my call back, and I got called to the Ohio Columbus Mission. And I really enjoyed my mission. I loved going out and telling people that they could know that Joseph Smith was a prophet if they just prayed and asked God, and God could give them an answer. And so I loved going out and telling people that. About 18 months into my mission, we had a special visitor, Elder Kikuchi, which is one of the general authorities. And to maybe help you understand what that means, you have the prophet of the church, then you have his 12 apostles, and then underneath them are general authorities. Okay, and so to have Elder Kikuchi come and visit your mission was very special. He gets up at the podium and he tells us that as missionaries, we need to have our own sacred grove. We need to be able to commit ourselves to follow God no matter what. And I really had a strong desire to want to do that. And so I went home that night and I prayed to God and I said, God, I want to follow you no matter how hard it is or whatever you want to put me through. And I had this really good, peaceful feeling again overcome me. And this question that came to my mind that said, Andy, would you follow me if your first wife was going to die? Because that's what's going to happen. I was like, again, a little bit more information than I wanted to know. But I thought, you know, there's got to be a reason for this. It's not a coincidence that Elder Kikuchi challenged us to do this. And it's not a coincidence that God is telling me this. And so I figured that God wanted to test me to see if I really was going to follow him. And so I told him, yes, I would follow him even if my first wife was going to die. So I get home from my mission, and I start attending the Singles Ward, which is right across the street from the Mesa Temple. I told you I had grew up in Cottonwood. Well, I had left from Cottonwood, but while I was gone, my family moved, and they went to Chandler. And so when I got back, I was in the valley. Boy, that was terrible. I got off the plane in June, and I was like, oh, man. I never missed Cottonwood more than when I got off that plane. Anyways, I started attending the Singles Ward that was right across the street from the temple. And I met my wife-to-be, and we started dating. And we get engaged, and about 2 weeks before we're to go through the temple to be sealed, I thought, you know, if she's going to be the one, I should probably tell her what I had received on my mission. Now, as you can imagine, that conversation didn't go exactly like I wanted it to. She didn't like the idea that she was going to die. And how I won her over is I said, well, look, Lori, I don't know when you're going to die. You could live a long life. I just know that you're going to die before I do. And so because I was the priesthood holder and she's a good Mormon woman, she just accepted what I had to say as being true. And so fortunately for me, we were still sealed in the temple 2 weeks later. We had a great marriage. Right after we got married, we started volunteering at the temple. And did visitor, they have these guides that walk people through, do tours down at the temple visitor center. And we did that. All it was is to help us explain what the gospel was while we're going around explaining what the temple was. When I say the gospel, I'm talking about the Mormon gospel, about Joseph Smith being a prophet, and you can pray about him and know that he's a true prophet. So we really enjoyed that. Then my wife got pregnant, and she had morning sickness, and she could no longer do that. And so we started off on our family right away. You know, we were very active in the church. 1 year, volunteered to be one of the shepherds in the Easter pageant. You guys have probably heard of the Easter pageant at the Mesa Temple, and maybe been even invited to it. I grew out my nice red beard, and I was up there and had a staff, and I really looked the part. So I was really excited about this church and the beliefs that I had. And so about 2 years into our marriage, we were already expecting our second child, so we were moving fast as Mormons would do. And there was a friend of my wife's family who had just lost her job and had just lost her place to stay. And at the time, we had an extra room. And we thought, you know, we could invite her into our house for a couple months and help her get on her feet, that would be the right thing to do. And so we invited her into our house. And now as soon as she came through my door, this is where some pretty strange things started happening. As soon as she walked through the threshold, I had this overwhelming, good, peaceful feeling, and this thought come to me that said, Andy, this person walking through your door is your next wife. And I was like, okay, I do not want to know this. I was actually pretty shocked by it. I didn't know what to do with it. I was scared because, the church isn't practicing polygamy right now, and what am I supposed to do with this? And then it got even stranger than that. as soon as she entered my door, she didn't call me by my first name, Andy, everywhere I went. When I went through the temple, and you have to understand this, as a Mormon, it's very sacred, and so you probably don't want to talk about this part with your Mormon friends and neighbors, but when you go through the temple, you're given a new name that you're never supposed to reveal to anyone. And I had never revealed my new name to anyone, but when she walked into my door, she called me by my new name everywhere I went. She called me Moses. And that was really shocking to me after just having this revelation. How in the world does she know my new name? And I am just frightened. So I keep it to myself. I don't know what to do with it other than to just, okay, I'm just going to try and forget about it, really. So the next day, I'm helping her drive around, helping her to look for work. And while I'm driving her around, I have this, again, this spiritual manifestation, really good, peaceful feeling. And this thought come to me that says, Andy, this person is supposed to be your next wife. And I'm angry at this point that I'm receiving this revelation right now. I'm thinking it's inappropriate. This should not be done right now. And while I'm having this internal struggle, she speaks out of her mouth of how she feels like she's supposed to be my second wife. And I couldn't believe that she said that. I mean, just unbelievable. How did she know that? And so we took that as a confirmation from God that we were supposed to be together. So the long story short, we committed adultery. I believe that she was my God-given wife directly from God to me. And I received another revelation at this time that Lori, my first wife, was going to die in childbirth, and God was going to make it all right that way. I was going to have one wife in the celestial kingdom, and I was going to have one wife here on earth. And so time comes for my wife Lori to deliver, and I'm expecting her to die on the table. And so we drive down to the hospital, and this is where everything goes wrong. She delivers a healthy baby boy, and she's fine. And I'm going, what am I going to do with this? She's not dead. And so I'm walking down the hallway, and I'm just confused, and I don't know what to do. And I believe this is where God reached down into my life, because I had this thought come to me that said, Andy, you're a false prophet. Your prophecy didn't come to pass. And I said, you're right. And so I went to my wife, Lori, told her everything that happened. I went back home and I kicked the other woman out of my house and told her that we had been deceived. And I went back to the LDS church so that I could go through the repentance process because I still believed it was true. And there was this nagging problem, though, that I had for the bishops and the stake presidents as I'm going through this repentance process. And this was my nagging problem. The two feelings that I had were identical. The one that told me that Joseph Smith was a prophet when I was 14 years old, and all the other ones that I knew that were false. And so the simple question I had for them is, how do I know what's from God, and how do I know what's from the devil, and how do I keep myself from being deceived ever and again in the future, because I never want this to happen again. And the best that they could tell me was that if I kept reading the Book of Mormon, that somehow God would reveal it to me. And so I continued to attend church. Now, it's kind of a rarity what happened to me when I went through the church court. Normally, for circumstances like mine, they would automatically excommunicate you. But because I was repentant and because I really just wanted to do what was right, they disfellowshipped me instead. And now what disfellowshipment means is that you can attend church, you don't lose your membership, but you can't partake of the sacrament, you can't talk in any of the meetings, you can't pray at church, and so you're kind of just there, and you're just listening to what everyone is saying. Now, I was not upset about that at all. I felt like I needed to be punished. You know, something needed to be done for what I had done, and so I didn't have a problem with the disfellowshipment, and I just wanted to make it right. And so I continued to go to church like this, and for 2 years. And it's very difficult because when you go to sacrament meeting, people pass the tray by and you have to not take it and you pass it on. And so everybody's wondering, well, what did he do that he can't partake of it? And then, you know, you get asked to pray at meetings and you have to decline and say that you can't. And then they go, oh, I wonder what he did. And so for, you know, 2 years, I'm just kind of there and taking my lumps, so to speak. But I was studying the scriptures and I was doing everything that I was supposed to do just so that I could find this answer, okay? I decided that I wasn't going to pray the way that I had prayed before and wait for a feeling to determine what truth was, because I knew that my feelings could lie to me. So I was studying diligently the scriptures just so that I could know what the differences were between those manifestations, because I needed to know what came from God and I needed to know what came from the devil. And I didn't find anything for what I was looking for, and there was no one at church that seemed to know the answer to this question. But I figured, you know, maybe if I can get my temple recommend back and I can go through the temple again, then I'll be able to get my answer at the temple. And so after 2 years, I get my temple recommend back, and so I have full fellowship with the church, and I start talking in church, and everybody's, well, what's up with Andy? He's talking at church, you know, so everything seems to be good. And I start attending the temple on a regular basis. I'm still reading my scriptures, and I'm not getting my answer. I'm not figuring out how to know what's from God and how to know what's from the devil. And so, I don't know, you know, I just keep struggling, you know, for 2 years of attendance. And I don't know if there's anything that I could really point to as just continual searching, talking to people. I talked to my dad about it. I talked to my dad's a former bishop, by the way, and I talked to several different people, but nobody seemed to have the answer for me. And at the end of those 2 years, I was feeling very separated from the members of the ward, because on the first Sunday of the month, they would get up and they would bear testimony about spiritual experiences that they had had and how they knew that Joseph Smith was a prophet, and all of them seemed to know what came from God and what came from the devil, and I didn't know. And I felt very separated from them. And it was very painful for me to listen to, because they seemed to know the answer and I didn't. And so after 2 years of activity and got my temple recommend back, I said, you know what? I'm not going to church anymore. It's too difficult to listen to that. I will stay at home and I'll read my scriptures. Lori, you can take the kids without me. And I just, it's too difficult to do that. And so I went inactive for 2 years. And still studying my scriptures, trying to find this answer. And at the end of that two-year period, I reached a real low point in my life. And I decided that God was not going to answer my prayer, because what I had done in committing adultery was so wrong and was so far beyond the saving power of Christ that I needed to shed my own blood or take my own life to be able to maybe have a hope that I might make it to the celestial kingdom. And so I planned out where and when and how, and I set the date for 2 weeks away. I went so far as to plan out how I could make sure that it wasn't hard to clean up, okay? That's how far my thinking had gone. And it was at this time that my brother Matt calls me up on the phone. Now, you have to understand, about the same time that I went inactive, my brother Matt had left the church, and he had converted to biblical Christianity. Now, the reason why he had left the church is he started studying the history of the LDS church and found a lot of things that he couldn't believe in and decided to leave. In fact, I remember a couple times where he would bring up stuff. You know, he'd invite all these LDS friends that he had over, and I would be there, and he would throw something out on the table, you know, some type of bit of history, and he would get everyone riled up, and he would laugh kind of in the background because it was so difficult for everyone there. And I remember taking him aside, and I said, you know, Matt, it's one thing to leave the church, but it's another thing to be completely harassing us about what we believe. And I said, you know, that is not Christ-like. That isn't the way that I think Christ would have done that. It caused my brother to back down in the way that he was approaching it. But that was one of my things my brother loved to do. Anyway, so my brother Matt calls me up on the phone, And he says, hey, we're having a computer party over at my house. If you bring your computer over, we'll hook them all together and we'll play games and kill each other. And I said, well, that sounds like fun. And so I went there 3 hours early, okay, because I had asked everyone else my question. But I hadn't asked my brother, and at this point, I have nothing to lose, okay? And so I figured, I'm going to ask him and see if he has the answer, because if he doesn't have the answer, I could still carry out my plan. I haven't lost anything. And so I told my brother that I had this scripture that kept returning to me at this time. And the scripture was about Jesus that had cast out this evil spirit had been cast out of a man. And this evil spirit roams the whole earth looking for a place to stay. And when he doesn't find a place, he goes, I'll go back to the place where I started. And so he comes back and he finds the man that he left originally, and he finds his house in complete order. And he goes find seven other spirits worse than himself, and the last state of the man is worse than the first. And I said, Matt, that is me. That is my future. I'm no longer being deceived by those demons anymore, but I'm empty. I don't have God, and I don't know what the truth is, and I don't know how to keep from being deceived. And so if I don't find this answer, that's going to be me. And so my brother, who's a lot smarter than I give him credit for, he said, you know, there's a book you need to read, Andy. And it was an early version of The False Prophecies of Joseph Smith by Dick Baer. And in that version, Dick has a letter that he wrote out. And the very first thing he wrote in the letter was, you can't trust your feelings. I was like, well, duh, I know that's true. But then he did something that really surprised me. He quoted two verses, Jeremiah 17:9 and Proverbs 28:26. Now, Jeremiah 17:9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things. Who can know it? And that was the first time I heard a biblical scripture that said that you couldn't trust your heart, that it could lie to you. And it really surprised me. And then in Proverbs 28:26, he that trusteth in his heart is a fool. And I was, whoa, the Bible's teaching me that I can't trust my feelings. And then he goes on and he says, you know, how you know a true prophet from a false prophet has to do with whether or not his prophecies come to pass. And I'm going like, wait a minute, this is very familiar to me, because I had had that happen. And it's a real logical test, you know. God knows what's going to happen before it happens. And if it doesn't happen, it didn't come from God. And then he quotes Deuteronomy 18:19-22, which essentially says, one false prophecy makes a false prophet. Now, I'm really excited at this point, because this is the answer that I was looking for. And it didn't have anything to do with feelings. It had to do a lot with research. But at the same time, I was really disappointed, because I started going through this book and realizing that Joseph Smith gave a whole bunch of false prophecies, things that never could come to pass. And I'm losing Joseph Smith as a prophet, and I don't want to lose him as a prophet. I want him to be a true prophet. But I want to follow the truth, no matter where it took me. And so I got to this one that Joseph Smith told a man in his patriarchal blessing that one day he would preach the gospel to men that live on the moon. And these men dressed like Quakers, and they lived to the age of 1,000 years. And I thought, you know, that's a slam dunk. We've been to the moon, and there's no Quakers living there. I'm going to take this home. I'm going to share this with my wife, and she'll leave the church, right? Real simple. 1 + 1 = 2. And so I go home, and I share this. I start sharing these answers from the Bible, and I told my wife, this is the answer I was looking for. And then I started sharing all of these false prophecies that Joseph Smith gave. And she would argue with some of them. Other ones she couldn't argue with. And I kept getting closer and closer to the man on the moon one, because I knew for sure if I let that one out, she's gone. And so finally we get to it, and I share that with one, that prophecy with her. And she rises up, and she is so angry. And she says to me, Joseph Smith never said that. And she ran out of the room, because she had never heard that before in her entire life. And so I ran after her, and I said, well, look, Lori, you the evidence to show you that he really did say this, would you then acknowledge that he's a false prophet? And so she kind of reluctantly agreed to that. And so I went back to my brother Matt. Okay, Matt, you've got to give me something that I can share with my wife that will help her to understand that that Joseph Smith really is a false prophet. So what do you got? And he goes, well, you need another book. And so he gave me his copy of Mormonism, Shadow or Reality by the Tanners, and told me to go down to Deseret Book and get a copy of Gospel Link 2001, because it had all of the early church history books on there, journal discourses and other things that I would need for references. Now, I knew the Tanners, okay? The Tanners were evil anti-Mormons, and the reason why they exist is because they hate Mormons. And I'm a Mormon, and so I'm thinking, you know, I'm not going to listen to any of the commentary that they have in here, because I really don't trust their intentions, okay? And I'm just going to look up the references that they have and see if they're in context. And so for the next 3 months, I started finding references that they gave, and then I would find them on Gospel Link 2001. And as I found them and made sure that they were in context and made sure that that's what they actually said, I would then share it with my wife. Now, my wife did not like all the stuff that I was sharing with her. She told me three things during these 3 months. You're ruining my life. Why can't you leave this alone? And you're going to outer darkness. Those are the three things that she kept telling me. Now, after doing this for 3 months, I became convinced that Joseph Smith absolutely was a false prophet by just studying the early church history in those books. It's amazing how church history and journal discourses suddenly become anti-Mormon when they come from Mormon sources. It's really strange. But I was still empty inside. Okay, I knew that Joseph Smith was a false prophet, but I did not know if I could believe in the Bible or if I could believe in Christ. And I just watched my religion just kind of shred to dust. And I kind of expected that when I started investigating Christianity, that Christianity was going to kind of do the same thing, go poof. But I still wanted to know what the truth was. And so I went back to my brother Matt and I said, hey, Matt, I've heard a lot of strange things about Christians, and I want to attend a Christian church somewhere, but I don't want to do it alone because I don't want to be alone in the same room with them. So is there some place that you could take me so I would feel a little safe? And so my brother Matt says, well, sure, come back here tomorrow and I'll take you over to Central Christian Church. Now, you have to understand, the next morning, I wake up and I go over there. My brother's wife is still Mormon, okay? She's still Mormon today. And she had learned about my brother's plan to take me to an apostate Christian church. And they had been fighting all morning about whether he was going to be able to do that. Well, fortunately for me, he was able to escape, and he took me to Central Christian Church. Now, I don't know if you guys have ever experienced this, but when I got there, I felt like the pastor was speaking right to me, okay? Because I had been taught all my life, and I kind of believe this about Christians, that Christians said that they believed in Jesus, but then they didn't try to keep the commandments. You know, just say and then you don't do anything. And so that's what I kind of expected. And so the pastor Cal gets up, and he says, you know, if we say that we are born again, that we have the Holy Ghost living right here in us, then the natural result of that is that we should want to try and keep the commandments. And I was floored. I couldn't believe that a Christian said that they should try and keep the commandments. So that intrigued me enough that I went back next week by myself, because my brother got in so much trouble that he could not be with me the next week. So I go to the church library, and I tell the librarian that I am coming out of Mormonism and that I have some pretty hard questions about the Bible and about Christianity. And I told her I wanted to know if there's a book I could read or a person I could talk to so that I could ask my hard questions. I told her I don't want to go through a class because I figured that my questions would shake somebody else's faith. If they want to be Christian, let them be Christian. I just wanted to know if there was any answers to my questions. And so there was a person that was returning a book at the time. It's called A Ready Defense by Josh McDowell. And she says, you need to read this book. And so she makes me a library card right there on the spot. Okay, I still have the library card. It's right here, okay? She doesn't know me from Adam, all right? And she makes me this library card, takes my information. I'm not even a member of the church, and she gives me the book to read, okay? And she takes my information and gives it to Jim and Judy Robertson at Concerned Christians so that they can answer my questions. So the next day, Jim calls up on the phone, and of course, I don't answer the phone, my wife does. And I don't understand this to this day, okay? But for some reason, she handed me the phone, okay? She knew it was the evil Jim Robertson, too. I still don't understand this, okay? Anyways, Jim tells me that they're teaching at Central Christian Church. They have a series that they're doing on Mormonism. They're explaining what the differences are. And so he told me if I came down that I'd be able to ask my hard questions and that he'd give me answers. And so I went down there, not really sure what I was going to run into, okay, because this was the evil Jim Robertson, and I still thought he was the evil Jim Robertson, and he just hates Mormons, that's why he's in the business, right? But I had read a lot of their books, and I knew what they were saying was true. And so I thought, well, I'll at least give them the benefit of the doubt. And so I went down there just to find out what this couple was like. And so when I went down there, Jim was there, his wife was there, and I was really expecting a long lecture about how bad I had been for being a Mormon and talking about all the things that were bad with Mormonism. But that's not what happened. The first question that they asked me was, how was my kids doing with the fact that I was leaving Mormonism? How was my wife doing with the idea that I was going to be leaving Mormonism? And then the last question they asked me was, did I have a reason to believe in the Bible? And did I have a reason to believe in Jesus? And so they told me that there was a support group for former Mormons that met down at Concerned Christians, okay? And these former Mormons just talk about the Bible, they talk about what they believe now, and that if I went down with them, I'd be able to fellowship with these guys. And so I said, you know what, this sounds interesting. Never met a former Mormon that's a Christian. This is intriguing. And so I went down. Now, you have to understand, before I went down, I was reading that book from Josh McDowell, A Ready Defense, and I was reading it from both ends, okay? And what that book did for me is it helped me to understand the evidence for the Bible, okay? I had no idea that there was nearly 6,000 Greek New Testament manuscripts, okay? I had no idea that they came from about, the early manuscripts, you know, dated as early as 70 AD, the later manuscripts dated as 450 AD, and so all throughout that time period. Now, what was fascinating is that they come from different locations, and when we bring these manuscripts together, guess what? They say the same thing. Now, in addition to that, we have, the Christians were translated in other languages, okay, and so as they were, because they wanted to spread the gospel, and not everybody spoke Greek. So they wrote it down and they translated it into other languages. Well, if we take the other languages from that same time period, we have 20,000 manuscripts from that time period. That's 25,000 manuscripts for the New Testament alone. That was huge. Okay, wow. I mean, I was just flabbergasted. I saw Mormonism just go poof. And here's Christianity. It has solid evidence for the Bible. And so, it was the first time that I believed that I had the words of Paul and Peter and the apostles, and that I just needed to know what they said and decide whether I believed what they taught was true. And so, in the back of the book, it shows how to become a Christian, okay? Say this little prayer, and you become a Christian. And, you know, it kind of showed a picture of me sitting on God's throne and all the universe out of order. And then it showed a picture of God sitting on that throne and me kneeling at God's feet and the universe in order. And I thought, you know, I really want that. So I said a little prayer that was in there, and I'm thinking, you know, that's too easy. There's got to be something else I need to do because that ain't it. I wonder what it is. So that night, I went down to Concerned Christians, and I told them that I was coming out of Mormonism, and that I was in the process of getting saved, because I knew for sure there was something else I needed to do, and they were going to tell me tonight. So what the Christians did for me that night is they opened up the scriptures, and they explained to me that salvation was not something that I did for God, but rather something God did for me. And let me share with you the scripture that broke the camel's back, so to speak. It's in 1 John 5, verses 11 through 13. And this is the testimony: God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. Now, you have to understand, I did not know what to look for, what was from God or what was from the devil. I didn't know. I was still confused on that. And I wanted to know that I could know that I was saved, but I had no idea how to know that I was saved. And so they opened up the scripture and they said to me, if you believe in the name of the Son, then you have eternal life. He has a Son, has life. He does not have the Son, does not have life. It's a real simple concept. And I realized that night that I had faith to believe that Christ rose from the grave and that He paid for my sins based on the testimony of the apostles. And so it was the first time that I realized that that applied to me. And it's sort of like discovering 2 plus 2 equals 4. One moment I did not know that 2 plus 2 equals 4, and the next moment I knew it. And the same way with this. One moment I didn't know that faith in Christ meant that I had eternal life at this moment, and the next moment I did. And so it wasn't like angels speaking or spiritual manifestation or feeling or a voice speaking from heaven saying, Andy, you're saved. No, it wasn't like that. It was, I knew that I had the faith, and so therefore I knew that I had eternal life. Now, these good Christians knew that my wife wasn't there at the meeting, and they knew that she was a Mormon. And they thought, you know what? We're going to pray that she's here next week. I thought, you know, that's really nice that they're praying for my wife, ruining my life, going to outer darkness. Why can't I leave this alone? No, she's not going to be there, okay? But I thought it was nice that they were praying for her, at least. So something happened that night. My wife saw the guy that left and had the whole weight of sins on his shoulders, wasn't sure if he was going to be there with God, and she saw the guy that came back that knew he was going to heaven. And she could see the hope that I had in my eyes, but I did not want to get in another argument with my wife, okay? And so I said, I just got saved tonight, but I don't want to talk about it. I'm just going to go to bed, and I'll tell you about it in the morning. And that's what I did. I went to bed. Now, my wife was just like, who is this guy? So a couple days later, I'm sharing some scriptures with my wife. And there were some scriptures that they had shared with me down at Concerned Christians. And they were Isaiah. And so I'm going to have you turn to it. Isaiah 43, verse 10. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, so that you may know and believe me and understand that I am He. Before me no God was formed, nor will there be one after me. And I said, Lori, that means that God the Father did not have a father who was a God, who had a father who was a God, who had a father who was a God. That wipes out all of God's fathers. And that also means, Lori, that you and I cannot become God someday. Now, my wife had a lot of respect for Isaiah. She had painted paintings from scriptures from Isaiah. And so when she read these verses, they really struck her. And she realized that Mormonism couldn't be true, and so her Mormon bubble just popped. Now, that was not very good for her. She was very upset at the moment. She started crying. And I'm a guy, okay? And I've just made my wife cry. I've broken it. So what does a guy do? You run out of the room and you let her cry, okay? You don't fix it. You hope it goes away. And that's what I did. So, a couple days later, my wife is absolutely depressed and really upset. She doesn't know what to do. I've just ruined her life, and she doesn't know how she's going to get out of it. And I said, well, look, Lori, it's one of two decisions. Either Mormonism is right, and you need to show me how it's right and bring me back into Mormonism, or Mormonism is wrong, and what I'm studying is true, that the Bible really is reliable and that we can be saved through this. And I told her that if she wanted to come down with me to Concerned Christians, I'd be happy to have her. Now, after talking with her for a long while, she finally decided that she would come down with me to Concerned Christians. Okay. Now, as soon as she made that decision, everything came out of her mouth of how she knew that Joseph Smith was a false prophet. Because remember those 3 months I was sharing all that stuff with my wife? Well, behind my back and without my knowledge, my wife was going online and she was verifying that everything that I was telling her was true. In fact, she had found some things that I didn't even know about. And she was excited and wanted to show those with me. But the reason why she didn't tell me is because I was ruining her life. Okay? And so you have to understand, it's a terrible transition, but this, long story short, God answered that prayer. She was there the next week at Concerned Christians, okay? And then 3 months later, she accepted Christ, and I got an opportunity to baptize her, okay? And so that's how me and my wife came out of Mormonism. All right, so if we could go back to this slide right here, okay? I want to go over a little bit about what I believed as a Mormon, okay? Now, you should have a piece of paper. If you don't have one, you can raise your hand, and I'm sure someone's got extra copies. Looks like we have a couple over here. Who's got the extra copies? Are we all out? Well, I hope we aren't all out. If we are all out, I will show you how you can find it later. Just ask me, okay? So what we're going to be talking about here is this is the Mormon worldview, okay? Now, you have to understand that this, if you look up at the upper left-hand corner, okay, this realms of deity, spirit, life, first estate, what I believed as a Mormon is that God the Father and his wives have been living there for, I don't know how long, eons? Okay, and during this time, they had been procreating and having spirit children. And according to Mormonism, all of us in this room were spirit children of Heavenly Father and one of his wives. That included Jesus and Lucifer. Jesus was our oldest brother. Lucifer was one of the firstborns. Okay, and they were probably the most noble of the spirits that were in heaven. Okay. And so God one day goes, you know what? My children cannot progress and become gods like me unless they receive a physical body. And so in order for that to occur, I have to create a world for them, and I have to, there has to be a fall so that they can have these physical bodies. And there also, because there has to be a fall and sin has to be introduced into the world, there also has to be a savior for the world. And so I need volunteers for who wants to be the Savior. And so Jesus said, I'll be the Savior. Lucifer said, I'll be the Savior. Jesus was chosen. Lucifer was not. Lucifer was angry that he was not chosen, and he started rebellion. And a third of our brothers and sisters followed Lucifer, and two-thirds of us followed after Jesus. Well, Lucifer was cast out with all of our brothers and sisters to the earth, never to receive physical bodies and never have an opportunity to become gods someday. The rest of us were sent down here to the earth, which is the second estate. That's the birth thing. See the little line that says birth, and then you got second estate, earth. Okay? And so the purpose of this life, from a Mormon perspective, is if you have a physical body, which all of us do, that if you learn how to keep all the commandments and you follow the right way that God has prescribed for us, that you, which is actually Mormonism, and you can see this little freeway here, faith, repentance, baptism, gift of the Holy Ghost, and then you have morality, loyalty, tithing, word of wisdom, duty, and then celestial marriage, which is getting married in the temple. Temple marriage is required for godhood. I can't be a god unless I have a goddess, okay? And so that's, if you look, celestial marriage gets you to the number one in the center. And then endowments, which is something that Mormons do through the temple, which is not marriage, which gets you to the level two in the celestial kingdom. And then there's a third one for baptism. So if you're baptized in the church but you don't go through the temple, then you would go to that area. And so those are the three levels within the celestial kingdom. Now, no one makes it to the celestial kingdom unless they learn how to keep all of God's commandments. That means you have to stop sinning. And if you don't do that, then you don't qualify for forgiveness or grace that comes from Christ. And so that's who goes to the celestial kingdom. Now, you look down, and there's a broad way underneath that, and it leads to the terrestrial kingdom. Now, the terrestrial kingdom is reserved for what I call the good people of the earth, you know, Christians who don't believe in Mormonism, but they live good lives, they don't accept Joseph Smith, they would go to the terrestrial kingdom. Or Mormons that believe in Mormonism, but they don't live all the commandments that they're supposed to, then they would go to the terrestrial kingdom. Okay, so they're for good people. And then there's a low way, okay, and they go to the telestial kingdom, and that's reserved for liars, murderers, adulterers. If you think about it, Adolf Hitler, he fit in very well in the telestial kingdom, okay? Now, on this sheet, they don't show you one other place. It's called Outer Darkness. Now, Outer Darkness is reserved for two types of individuals. The ones that were cast out in the pre-existence, Satan and his angels, that are never supposed to be physical bodies, they would go to Outer Darkness. They don't go to any one of the three kingdoms. And there's one other type of individual that will qualify. Someone that had a testimony to know that Joseph Smith was a prophet, and then deny that testimony and then fight against the church. That would be me. Okay? And so... this is where it kind of gives you an idea in the Mormon mindset where I sit on the totem pole, okay? It's also another reason why it's so difficult for people coming out of Mormonism, because they don't know where they're going to go. My wife is telling me I'm going to Outer Darkness because she's hoping that will frighten me back into the church. And there also is this loss of family and friends that people have when they're coming out of Mormonism. Sometimes it can even involve losing your job. And so for a Mormon to come out of Mormonism, they really have to know that it's false, you know, that it's something that cannot be relied on, okay? They also have to know that there's something to believe in. I know so many Mormons that I've heard about who are what I call cultural Mormons. They don't believe in Mormonism. They've done too much research and found out that they can't believe in it. But they think that it's a good way of living and that there's nothing else out there worth believing in. And so they'll just stay a Mormon. And that's all that they want to do because it's a good life. And I'm not here to bash the Mormon lifestyle. The Mormon lifestyle really is a good life. They live the commandments. They try to have good family structures. I'm not here to belittle that. But what I am here to do is to share what I have gained in Christ since I have left Mormonism, because if I didn't have something to share with them, then there would be no point of me being here. All right? So, with that being said, I want to explain a little bit of what it takes to come out of Mormonism. So if you go to the next slide, there are three things that every Mormon needs to have when they're coming out of Mormonism. First off is they need to have a reason to doubt Mormonism. Now, that's probably the most dangerous one of all of them that's on the list. Because if I just give you a reason to doubt Mormonism, but I don't give you a reason to believe in Christ or to believe in the Bible, then I haven't improved your condition. Okay? If you come out of Mormonism and you just become an atheist, I haven't helped you. Okay? You're not going to heaven. I'm going to heaven. You're still not going to heaven. Okay? That doesn't help. But you do have to have that reason to doubt. I do a radio program where we interview people that have come out of Mormonism. It's called Out of Mormonism, real simple radio program. And we broadcast in Salt Lake City. We also podcast at outofmormonism.com, and so you can go and listen to the testimonies that are there. And out of the people that I have interviewed, people that have come out of Mormonism, each one of them had to have a reason to doubt Mormonism. But what's fascinating is each one of them had a different reason. Okay? I haven't found many of them that are similar at all. God uses different things to reach different people. And so I want to say this. There is not one way to witness to a Mormon. Okay? There are lots of ways. Whatever your way is, I want you to use that. I'm trying to give you tools that you can adapt and use whatever way that you have, because your way is going to touch a certain individual a certain way that I wouldn't be able to do. They also need to have a reason to believe in the reliability of the Bible. Okay? We're starting with scratch with Mormons. They've been taught all their life that the Bible has been corrupted, it's been changed. Let me read to you what it says in 1 Nephi chapter 13. You really need to understand this. This is what Mormons believe happened to the Bible. This is Nephi, and he is a prophet, according to the Book of Mormon, that lived about 600 years before Christ, and he's having a vision in which he's speaking to an angel, okay, much like John the Revelator in the Book of Revelations. And the angel said, an angel of the Lord said unto me, thou hast beheld that the book that proceedeth forth from the mouth of the Jew, and when it proceedeth forth from the mouth of a Jew, it contained the fullness of the gospel of the Lord, of whom the 12 apostles bear record, and they bear record according to the truth which is in the Lamb of God. Wherefore, these things go forth from the Jews in purity unto the Gentiles, according to the truth which is in God. And after they go forth by the hand of the 12 apostles of the Lamb, from the Jews unto the Gentiles, thou seest the formation of that great and abominable church, which is most abominable above all other churches. For behold, they have taken away from the gospel of the Lamb many parts which are plain and most precious, and also many covenants of the Lord have they taken away. And all this they have done that they might pervert the right ways of the Lord, that they might blind the eyes and harden the hearts of the children of men. All right, and so the Bible is corrupt, according to Mormonism. That it's got things. What I used to believe as a Mormon is that Mormonism was taught from Adam all the way up to Christ. And it was after the death of the last apostle that the Bible was taken and mutilated, and they pulled Mormonism out of it. And what we have today is this easy believism stuff in the Bible, right? And that easy grace that Mormons hate so much. And so they're taught that they can't rely on this. And so we need to give them a reason for why this is reliable. If I can prove to them that the words of Paul and Peter and the prophets from the Old Testament have not been changed or altered, then these words become powerful. And if I can do that one thing, then the Bible itself will bring them out of Mormonism, because Mormonism isn't taught in here. Okay? And the biblical Christianity, the faith that we have in Christ that's presented in here is worthwhile. It's full of hope. It gives us a reason to live. And so the last thing that they need to know is they need to know what the Bible teaches, because they've been taught so many things that they just don't have an understanding about that. So let's go on to the next slide. Now, my first real reason to doubt came from Mormonism Shadow Reality. Now, there are a number of ministries out there that provide resources that people can go to. But I'm going to warn you, okay? This is the most dangerous part of coming out of Mormonism. I could come out of Mormonism, but then I don't necessarily have a reason to believe in anything. And so what I would recommend doing is spending time understanding what the Book of Mormon says and witnessing to them, because this is going to sound funny. There are many passages in the Book of Mormon that disagree with current Mormonism, okay? And so I want to do a quick comparison really quick here. This is a statement by Joseph Smith in the Teachings of the Prophet Joseph Smith by Joseph Fielding Smith. I will preach on the plurality of gods. I have always declared God to be a distinct personage, Jesus Christ a separate and distinct personage from God the Father, and that the Holy Ghost was a distinct personage of Spirit, and that these three constitute three distinct personages and three gods. So how many gods are there according to Joseph Smith? Three. Okay, now this is my favorite verse from the Book of Mormon. So write this down. This is in Alma chapter 11, verses 26 through 29. And this is a conversation between Zeezrom, who is an evil lawyer, who's trying to trick Amulek, who's a missionary for God. Okay? And so this is what Zeezrom says. And Zeezrom said unto him, "Thou sayest there is a true and living God?" And Amulek said, "Yea, there is a true and living God." And Zeezrom said, "Is there more than one God?" And so what should Amulek's response be if he's following Joseph Smith? There should be three gods, okay, over this world, all right? And he answered, no. Okay, so Amulek is saying that there's only one God. But that's disagreeing with what Joseph Smith later taught. Now, if I shared that with you as a Mormon, what are you going to do with that? Okay, because now you have contradictions with what Joseph Smith taught and what the Book of Mormon taught, and both of them have to be right. Is that a reason to doubt? It's a big reason to doubt. And we're talking about the nature of God. Okay, and it just happens to agree with what the Bible teaches. Now you can share with them those scriptures from Isaiah 43, verse 10, Isaiah 44, verses 6 and 8. Okay. Now we have the Bible agreeing with the Book of Mormon, but disagreeing with Mormonism. Okay, and so they have a reason to doubt Mormonism. Let's go to the next slide. Now, I was telling you about Josh McDowell's book, A Ready Defense. I can't express to you how important works like these are for helping Mormons understand what the truth is. Now, I'm going to say something about Josh McDowell. He is a great resource. He has a lot of stuff in there, but the problem is it's very hard to understand, okay? You have to have almost like a college-level understanding or education to really get this. But I want to share with you some of the things that are in there. And I don't know if you can really make out that slide very well, but this was the manuscripts I was telling you about, nearly 6,000 Greek New Testament manuscripts. That is huge. I mean, coming from different locations, different places. And then if we look at the other languages, go down a little bit there, all the way to the bottom, there's a whole bunch of it. Okay, there you go. 19,284 manuscripts from other languages, okay, from the same time period. The total manuscripts is almost 25,000 manuscripts. Now, that is huge, okay? Now, in addition to all of these manuscripts that are for the New Testament, you guys have probably heard about the Dead Sea Scrolls, okay? Dead Sea Scrolls, we had the entire Old Testament, all the books that were in there, okay? Minus the book of Esther, okay? Now, what was fascinating is we found a full Isaiah scroll in this manuscript find. Now, and I think the next slide is going to tell me a little bit about that. Let's see here. Yes, this video right here does a wonderful job of presenting the evidence for the Dead Sea Scrolls and comparing it with the Book of Mormon. Now, you have to understand, Joseph Smith, when he did the Joseph Smith translation of the Bible, He added three chapters to the book of Isaiah. He also, when he did the Joseph Smith translation, he also added those chapters to the Book of Mormon. So the Book of Mormon quotes Isaiah many times. And those three chapters that he changed are found in the Book of Mormon. And so the Book of Mormon and the Joseph Smith translation agree with each other. Problem is that the Isaiah scroll, which dates 300 years before Christ, before what the Book of Mormon said, could have changed, okay? Because remember, after the apostles were killed, according to the Book of Mormon, the Bible was changed. And so this manuscript predates that. And so that Isaiah matches the Isaiah that we have in our Bibles. And those three chapters that Joseph Smith added are not there. Now, I'm going to let you guess. What do you think those three chapters are about? They're not about polygamy. Good guess, not it. They're about the Book of Mormon coming forth and Joseph Smith being a prophet of the restoration. See, he needed to write himself into the Bible. He needed to write the Book of Mormon into the Bible. And so he did it in Isaiah. Okay, the problem is that the Dead Sea Scrolls destroys that. But this is the thing that's so great about this. This video presents the evidence in an easy way to understand. It talks about the scriptures from the Book of Mormon, compares them with the evidence for the Bible, talks about fulfilled prophecies for Jesus being the Messiah from the Old Testament. When somebody watches this video, not only do they have a reason to doubt Mormonism, but they have a strong reason to believe in the Bible and to believe in Jesus as the Messiah. This conquers two of the things that someone needs in order to come out, and it does it in an easy way. Let's go on. Now, understanding the teachings of the Bible is the next step that every Mormon needs to have. Now, there are two ministries that I would strongly recommend. Concerned Christians is one, okay? They helped me and my family when we came out, and we have a Bible study that we do for Mormons coming out of Mormonism so that we can go over what the Bible says and why it says what it says, and what it means. Now, I'm also going to recommend this as a resource. It's called The Mormon Scrapbook. It's written by Pastor Chip Thompson. And this is a wonderful resource for teaching you how to use the Book of Mormon as a witnessing tool. But not only that, it's going to help you explain what the Bible teaches to Mormons so that they get exposed to what the teachings are of the Bible. You have to understand that this book had a profound impact on me when I was coming out of Mormonism. Would you go on to the next slide? Now, I don't know how many... I'm going to ask this question. Can anyone in this room explain to me why you believe in the Trinity? Can you pull out scriptures and explain to me why? Most Christians that I asked this question to when I was coming out of Mormonism, what they would do is they would give me bad examples of how the Trinity works. Okay, let me give you a few of them, okay? You've probably heard the egg example, okay? God is like an egg, okay? There's a shell, there's an egg white, and there's an egg yolk, so God's like an egg. I was like, okay, well, that's really interesting. It gives me the concept of the Trinity, but where does it say in the Bible that God is like an egg? And they'll say, well, I don't know. And okay, I got another one for you. This is great, okay? God is like water, okay? Because water, at a certain pressure and a certain temperature, is solid, it's gas, and it's liquid all at the same time. So God is like water. I was like, well, that's really great illustration, but where does it say in the Bible that God is like water? It's not in there, okay? So what I needed is I needed scriptures to help me to understand the Trinity, because I've been taught all my life that the Trinity was an evil concept designed by men, and it wasn't in the Bible. Okay, it wasn't, and the classic argument they would use is the word Trinity isn't in the Bible, and so that's how you disprove the Trinity. Well, I'm going to share with you two scriptures that had a profound effect on me, and they came from this little Trinity diagram from the Mormon scrapbook. If you go on the back of the Mormon scrapbook, you'll find this little diagram. And you know what? These triangles are great right here, but the triangles are just like the water or the egg, okay? All it does is show you the concept. It doesn't prove anything, okay? It's all the scriptures on here that does the proving, okay? And the scriptures are on the back. This is where all the power is, okay? You'll notice there's a 1, there's a 2, and there's a 3. Now, I need to explain something to you. Everywhere in the Old Testament where you see the word Lord in all capital letters, that was translated from the name of God, Yahweh or Jehovah, okay? And so we can transliterate. We can go through and we can say, when we see Lord in capital letters, that was Jehovah or Yahweh. That's his name, okay? And so let me share with you 2 scriptures that help me to understand that the Father was Jehovah, okay? Now, as a Mormon, I got to explain this to you. Mormons believe there are 3 gods. Elohim is God the Father's name, okay? So Elohim is 1 God. Jehovah is Jesus Christ before he was born. So Jehovah's the 2nd God. And then you have the Holy Ghost. Now, we don't have the Holy Ghost name, but he is a separate God, okay? Now, the reason why this is because Heavenly Father, or Elohim, Jehovah, or Jesus, and the Holy Ghost are all men, just like me. And the whole purpose of this existence is so that I could become a God like Heavenly Father. And so each one has to be a separate God because they're men. They have physical bodies. You can touch them. So these scriptures had a profound effect on me. The first one is in Psalms 2:7. I will proclaim the decree of the Lord, or Jehovah, okay? He said to me, so who's speaking? Jehovah or Yahweh? You are my son. Today I have become your father. Now, as a Mormon, that scripture by itself really doesn't have any power because they believe we're all sons and daughters. And even though this is talking about Jehovah being our father, they'll say, well, because Jehovah saved us, or Jesus saved us on the cross, we're spiritually his children because of that reason, okay? But the verse that makes all the difference is found in Acts 13, verses 32 through 33. Now, if you don't use this verse in conjunction with Psalm 2:7, everything I just said about Psalm 2:7 goes flying out the window. You have to use Acts 13, 32 through 33. The reason why is because Luke, the writer of Acts, gives an explanation or an interpretation of Psalm 2:7. Okay, and so let's turn to Acts 13, 32 through 33. We tell you the good news. What God promised our fathers, he has fulfilled for us, their children, by raising up Jesus. So who are we speaking about? We're speaking about God and Jesus, the Son, right? As it is written in the 2nd Psalm. So what psalm are we quoting? The 2nd Psalm. We just read from the 2nd Psalm. You are my son. Today I have become your father. Who was the one that said that? Jehovah said that in Psalm 2:7. What does that literally mean? That means that Jesus the Son is the son of Yahweh or Jehovah. So Jehovah is the Father. Now, I can go through the Bible numerous times and show you that there's only one Jehovah. And from my Mormon mind, it just exploded because Jehovah or Jesus has just become his own father. Okay? And I began to realize that the concept of the Trinity is in here. And so the reason why I believe in the Trinity is because what the Bible teaches about it. Mormons will often say, well, you just believe in the Trinity because of the Nicene Council and what it said. And they blame everything on the Nicene Council. And, you know, I love it when they do that because I will say, you know, that's a really interesting statement. I've asked a lot of Christians about why they believe in the Trinity. I've yet to have them come back and say, oh, the Nicene Council said it, so therefore it must be true. No one says that. The reason why they believe it is because this is what the Bible teaches. And so therefore it's true. Let's go to the next slide. So I want to finish up by explaining what my new relationship with Jesus is. And this makes all the difference, guys. These six things that I'm about to bring up to you is the reason why I have hope. As a Mormon, I never had this hope. And it's the whole reason why I'm in this ministry, is because I want people to know the hope that I have in Jesus. The first thing that I learned is that my forgiveness from God comes before I do any good works. In Mormonism, it teaches after. In 2 Nephi 25:23, "For we labor diligently to write, to persuade our children and also our brethren to believe in Christ and to be reconciled to God. For we know that it is by grace that we are saved." Now, if we put a period right there, I would completely agree with that verse. But they put a comma, and it says, "after all that we can do." So when do I receive the grace? It's after everything that I can do. Now, I want to share a verse with you. Go to the next one. This is, and you can't, I don't know if you can read that very well up there. So I'm going to have you turn to Romans 4, verses 7 through 10. Because these verses, they have so much power in them. There's so much hope that's found in here. "Blessed are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will never count against him. Is this blessedness only for the circumcised or also for the uncircumcised? We have been saying that Abraham's faith was credited to him as righteousness. Under what circumstances was it credited? Was it after he was circumcised or before? It was not after, but before." Abraham, before he was circumcised, before he did any good work, was given forgiveness by God. Now, I love to make this point, okay? You guys are probably familiar with this. In the Old Testament, the covenant that they made with God was circumcision. In the New Testament, the covenant that we make with God is baptism. So this is like saying that Abraham received his righteousness, his forgiveness, before he was baptized. That's huge. That's amazing. And you know what that means? That means I have a hope that starts right now, the moment that I believe. It's huge. Let's go to the next one. Oh boy, you're not going to be able to read this too well, I don't think. I'll try and read this. "Mormonism, Perfection is Required" by Spencer Kimball. Okay. "In our journey toward eternal life, purity must be our constant aim. To walk and talk with God, to serve God, to follow His example and become as a God, we must attain perfection. In His presence there can be no guile, no wickedness, no transgressions. In numerous scriptures He has made it clear that all worldliness, evil, and weakness must be dropped before we can ascend unto the hill of the Lord." That is a huge weight. Can you understand? As a Mormon, I was carrying this around. Now, I was willing to pay this weight because the reward was great. I was going to become a god of my own world and have my children pray to me. I was looking forward to that. That's what I wanted. The problem is no one can be perfect. There are many Mormons that are depressed and upset because they cannot reach this perfection that's required. Let's go to the next slide. And this is a strange scripture to be happy about, but this is the second thing that I learned. I don't have the ability to be perfect. There's two scriptures that I want to share. It's in Romans 7:18. "I know that nothing good lives in me. That is my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out." I cannot carry it out. You know, if Paul can be saved in that condition, which is describing the condition that I am in, and I can be saved, just like him. And I love to quote 1 John 1:8, "If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." See, I was striving all my life to be perfect, which was impossible in this life to attain. The only perfection that I will get is the perfection that comes from Christ as a gift. And one day, I have a promise, one day, that I will receive a perfect body from Him, a glorified, resurrected body that will no longer sin against God. And I look forward to that day because I hate this wretched body that I'm in right now. And I want to do away with it. But I know that Christ has taken care of me. So if it doesn't matter if I live the rest of my life without perfection, I know that it's promised for me. I know that I have that waiting for me in heaven. And so it's the same way that Paul was looking forward to. So let's go to the next slide. Now, this is another one that's really important. Christ saved me while I was still a sinner. Okay, not after I had reached the perfection of righteousness, but while I'm still a sinner. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That doesn't mean I have to be perfect in order to receive forgiveness. That means that the state I'm in right now, I can be forgiven. Let's go to the next slide. Now, in Mormonism, I learned that sins returned to me. This is one I had read, Miracle of Forgiveness, on my mission. And by the way, if you ever attempt to witness to Mormons, you really need to understand what Mormons believe. And the only way, because a lot of this stuff what I'm saying to you seems, Mormons can't really believe that, can they? You know, you need to read this book. And it's the first time I'm recommending a book written by a Mormon prophet, okay? It's Spencer Kimball, okay? And it's called Miracle of Forgiveness. And he explains in here why the Mormon needs to be perfect in order to make it. And he uses, he quotes from Doctrine and Covenants, section 82, verse 7, as part of his case. And he said, "And now verily I say unto you, I the Lord will not lay any sin to your charge. Go your ways and sin no more. But unto the soul that sinneth shall the former sins return, saith the Lord your God." How many of you have returned to the sins that you've been repentant of? I have. According to Mormonism, those sins that I repented of, and whenever I talk to Mormons, they all say, well, that's just a category of sins. I don't care if it's a category of sins or if it's all of my sins coming back. It doesn't matter. If it's just my lies coming back or just if I stole something in all my times I ever stole something in my life, the problem is that my former sins are returning, and that means I won't be with God. I'm out. Okay? And so that's a heavy weight to carry. You never know if you're going to be there. Go to the next slide. In my missionary days, after I read this Miracle of Forgiveness, you have to understand, I learned that I needed to be perfect. I learned that my former sins returned. And there was times where I felt like God was returning the sack of sins at my doorstep and asked me, "Andy, when are you going to stop sinning so that I can completely forgive you?" And I would tell him, "Oh, I don't know, God. I'm really trying hard to do that. I haven't figured out how to do it. I'm going to keep trying." And so I used to do some things that you probably are going to sound pretty strange, okay? As a Mormon missionary, I knew that if somebody killed me on my mission, that was a straight ticket to the celestial kingdom. And so I used to hope, and I know this sounds strange, I used to hope that as I was out tracting and knocking on doors in Columbus, Ohio, that someone would come along and shoot me at the door, because that was a straight ticket. I knew I'd get in. You know, at that point, it was a way that I could get there. Now, I was realistic. I knew it was not likely that someone was going to come and shoot me at the door. And so I tried to think of ways that I could get around this. And so what I used to tell myself is, well, Nephi did it, Joseph Smith did it, other prophets have done it, so there must be a way to do it. I just haven't figured out what that is. And the problem is that only works for a limited number of days, okay? Because after a while you go, well, maybe I'm not really one of those types of individuals because I'm not doing it, and I can't figure it out. And so one of the things I used to do is I used to say, well, you know, they tell me that right after I partake of the sacrament at church, that it's just like I've been baptized and all my sins are washed away. And so I'm thinking, maybe what will happen is Christ will return right after I partake of the sacrament. Or maybe I'll die right after I partake of the sacrament. And then I'll be able to make it. Well, the problem with that is that I'd go to church and I'd partake of the sacrament and I would try really hard not to sin. I would try really hard to avoid doing those things that were wrong. Most of the time, it was only 15 minutes before I found myself doing something wrong. One of the speakers would be up there and they'd be taking a really long time and I'd be like, oh, why? What? Oh, no! Dang it! Oh, shouldn't be doing that. I should be loving what they're saying. Then I'd have to wait a whole nother week, okay, until I get the sacrament again. Now, if I was really good, I might go 3 hours through the whole church block series and make it without sinning. Now, that's really hard. If you've ever tried it, it is very difficult to avoid sinning because thought sins can get you, sins of omission. There's lots of sins, okay? So I make it, and I get in the car, and I'm driving out the... And somebody pulls in front of me. I'm like, oh, no, not again. No. Dang it. He who hates his brother just committed murder. And I'd be like, no. No. Oh. I don't know how to describe that, but that's the kind of weight that I was carrying. It's heavy. It's miserable. It's Chinese water torture. Okay? Go to the next slide. Now, Mormonism teaches that my sins return to me, but the Bible teaches that my sins are taken away from me permanently. I love this scripture in Psalm 103, verses 11 through 12. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Now, this is a huge verse, okay? God didn't say as far as the north is from the south. Now, there's a north pole and there's a south pole. Okay, now if I go and I stand at the north pole, at that point, everywhere I look is south. If my sins were moved as far as the north is from the south, you'd be able to find all of my sins right there. If I went to the south pole, same thing. Everywhere I look is north. You'd be able to find all of my sins right here. But God said as far as the east is from the west. Now, I can keep going east, and I how far I go, it doesn't turn into west. I can turn around, and I can keep going west, and there's no point that it becomes east. My sins have literally dropped off the map. They cannot be found. If they can't be found, they can't be returned to me. They're gone. Let's go to the next slide. Now, I have an eternal security in Jesus. I love this verse in John 10:28. I give them eternal life. This is Jesus speaking. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Never perish. I'm going to say it one more time. Never perish. They shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. If I have eternal life, if I have what Jesus says there, I am in, because no one can snatch me out of his hand. I shall never perish. I have a hope that carries on. Let's go to the next verse. This is another one from Philippians about eternal security. Being confident in this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. He will carry it on to completion. He has the power. He has the ability. We don't have to worry. And hope has a new meaning for me. You have to understand, as a Mormon, I thought I knew what hope was. I didn't know what hope was. I was hoping that I would be good enough, and that's as far as hope went for me. Okay? Hoping that you'll be good enough is not real hope. See, hope is something that is secure, something that you know you cannot lose. Otherwise, it's not hope. It's just a promise. And promises mean nothing if you can't fulfill them. Very, very truly, I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. When does that occur? Whoever hears and believes him who sent me. the moment that I believe I have crossed from death to life, we just read the other verse, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. From here to eternity, I am wrapped in the arms of God, knowing that I am secure in Him. Hope has a new meaning. It's sure. It's something that cannot be taken away. And I think that's the last slide. Is that the last slide? All right. So I'm going to open it up for questions. I know you guys probably have questions that you are dying to hear about. So I'll answer those for you.
We all know Mormons that are friends, neighbors, coworkers, whatever. And the thing that I've always had a great difficulty with is how they maintain such a strong family presence, that their children abide by everything they say. But I'm guessing now that just from what you've been saying, that it might be totally out of that fear.
Yeah, fear is the prime motivator in Mormonism. Mormons really have a hard time believing that it's impossible to keep the commandments of God without being afraid. And because when I tell them, you have eternal life right now, they say, well, what's the reason for keeping the commandments? See, that's the first question that they ask. Well, what's the reason for keeping the commandments? Well, I'd like to share that with you. I have an answer for that. This is in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. And I'm telling them, if you're still afraid about whether you're going to be there with God, you haven't known the love of God, because the love of God drives out fear. I believe that it is impossible for anyone to keep the commandments of God until they have been set free by Christ. Because before that time, everything I ever do is always done so that it will benefit me. But the kind of love that's described here is not deserved love. And if I am to love the way God loves, then I have to love you even if you don't deserve it, and whether I'm going to get anything. And so until I was set free in Christ, I could not really keep His commandments. I could not really love someone because it was all about me. Now it's not about me. I can love you because I want to, not because I have to. And so it's genuine. All right.
Hi. My husband and I, our family lives in Turkey, and we used to see or hear about Mormons being there, but it seems that they've kind of abandoned Turkey. Now, why would they leave a country? What's their view on missions in a hard, hostile land? Would they just abandon them, are they looking more for a place that has fruit?
Well, you have to understand, from a Mormon perspective, the ones that do missionary work are usually young kids, 19, 20 years old. They do not want to send them in a land where those kids could be killed, okay? Even though that would have been a great thing for me, but they really aren't. So the only reason why I would think that they would pull them out is because they just don't want to put them in danger, okay? And so missionary work is really done behind the scenes in that case. Church leaders would try and visit the country and try and make it a safer place for them to do missionary work. But they're really looking for youth to go there.
You talked about using a lot of different literature when you converted. How do you get other Mormons to read texts not approved by the LDS Church?
Well, actually, all the texts that I learned from Shadow Reality, they're all approved texts. They're all published by the church. There's a number of different ways that you could go about it. You could say, well, are you saying that the older the church material is, the more that you can't read it? Or are you not willing to read what President Kimball or President Brigham Young or even Joseph Smith said? Because these are what they actually taught during the time period, okay? And so if I can't believe them in these books, then I can't believe them anywhere else either.
What seems to
Okay, so why do people join the Mormon Church, or why is it flourishing? Well, actually, it really comes down to a simple thing. If I can convince you that how you know anything is true is by prayer, by asking God whether it's true or not, and you have those spiritual manifestations, and it's not, you don't test it by what's in here, what's in the Bible, because this has been corrupted, then that's really attractive, okay? Because if God tells me directly, then I have a reason to believe in Mormonism. In addition to that, they have strong families and they have good culture and they've done the family right, okay? And so they have a great culture. There's a lot of things that I love about the Mormon culture, okay? And so that's why it's so attractive. Okay, over here.
I have a Mormon friend and we were talking one day and we talked about doing a different Bible study in one of our classes, and they said, oh, we're Christians too. How do you respond to that?
Well, as a Mormon, I would argue that I was a Christian too. That's a really tough question to answer, and I didn't realize that I wasn't a Christian like everybody else until I started studying what the Bible taught about God. And I realized that the God that I used to worship as a Mormon, who was my brother, is not the same as the one God of the Bible, who's Jesus. You know, God who became a man, not a man who became a God. And, you know, I don't know if I would address that directly if I was talking to a Mormon, because they're just going to be offended by that. The thing that I would want to do is I'd like to talk to them about, well, what do you believe about God? You know, if you could share with them a quote from Joseph Smith where he says there's three gods, and then read from the Book of Mormon where it says there's only one God, and then you can show them a couple passages from the Bible that says that there's one God, well, that's going to show them that there's a difference. And then they're going to realize right away that the God that you worship is different than the God that they worship.
There are a lot of similarities with Mormonism and with Islam. And you have the Book of Mormon, they have the Quran, they have the Hadith, which is their sayings and whatnot, and that's a similar situation in the Mormon Church with these other...
Doctrine and Covenants, maybe Pearl of Great Price, I would guess would be the sayings, or similar to the sayings. I mean, it's even more similar to that. You have the Angel Gabriel, Angel Moroni, and so there's similarities. And a lot of Mormons are not aware of this, but there was a time where Joseph Smith said that it would be Mormonism or the sword, just like... In Muslim religion, you know, it was either the Quran or the sword. And there was a stretch of period when he was in Missouri where they were actually driving the Gentiles out, burning their houses down. They were killing people. He ended up in Liberty Jail over that, and paid a guard to get out. That's a long story in itself. The governor didn't even chase him because he just figured he's not my problem anymore. He's in Illinois. Let them deal with him. Yeah, very similar. A lot of similarities back and forth.
I had two Mormon elders recently, and why do they want to say that Jesus came to New York and they when that's been proven and not true?
Well, from a Mormon perspective, they would say that it has because they believe the Book of Mormon. I mean, they simply don't have any evidence for the Book of Mormon. They don't know that. They prayed about the Book of Mormon, and the Book of Mormon says that Jesus did visit the Americas. You're talking about a worldview there. I mean, you have to go a step beyond that, talking about why the Bible's reliable, talking about the evidence for the Bible, and let the Bible itself show them that Mormonism isn't teaching the same thing.
I once heard there was so many slots up in the celestial kingdom, So I didn't know if that was true or not.
So many slots, meaning like there's only a limited number of people that can become gods? Is that
right,
what you're saying?
Right, yeah.
No, I think you're actually probably confusing that with Jehovah's Witnesses. There's only a limited number there. But if in Mormonism, if every son or daughter of God perfected themselves, they could all become gods.
Was there an original God?
That's a great question. In fact, that's a question you would love to ask a Mormon, okay? Because you don't have an original God, okay? Essentially, they don't know where it all started from, because God the Father had a father who was a God, who had a father who was a God, and so on and so on. And my brother Matt, he asked me this question kind of in a different way. He goes, okay, Andy, what side of the fence were you on? Okay, well, what do you mean? Well, you had to believe as a Mormon that either there was a great God that started it all, that always has been God, okay? Or you believe that the first God kind of crept up out of the ooze and evolved and became the first God and then started it all. So which were you? You know, this way or that way? I said, well, I guess I would have to lean towards the first God that started everything. Now, if you ever have a conversation with a Mormon, okay, and you ask them that question, and then they tell you which side, and they tell you that they're, you know, believe that there was a first God that started it all, that's great, because the God that I am proclaiming, the God of the Bible, he is that God. He's the God that started everything, okay? And so that's the God that I'm talking about, that always has been, always will be.
The number of children that a Mormon family has, I know there's pressure, I believe, to have many children. So what about a childless couple? Is there more pressure, or is that considered a sin?
It's not actually a sin not to have children, or if you can't have children. They want to have children for one reason. They believe that in the preexistence, there are spirits waiting to come down here and be born into families. And if they're not born into Mormon homes, then they won't have the opportunity to hear the gospel, the true gospel of Mormonism. And they could be born in an atheist home or a Buddhist home or a Christian home, but they're not getting the fullness of the gospel. So in that case, what Mormons would be encouraged to do if they can't have kids is to adopt. Because then you're taking those kids out of whatever homes that they were in and giving them an opportunity to hear the truth.
Do you believe that Mormons are aware of the discrepancies in their religion? Or do you think that they just close their ears and say, la, 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 la?
Mormons are
definitely... Maybe they don't know what they believe.
Mormons are definitely not aware. There's a lot of reasons for that. First reason is Mormons are very busy. They have so much to do, okay? They really don't have time to research and study and do all of that stuff. They've got to go through the temple. They got to do their visiting teaching, the home teaching. They got to prepare for their lesson each week, you know, at church. These are busy people, and they got family home evening, and you got to take the kids down on Wednesday night. And so by the time you're done with all the things that you're doing, and don't forget, you have to do your genealogy. You know, you got to find all your dead relatives so that you can bring them to the temple and do the temple work for them. So by the time you're done, you really don't have time to look at all of this stuff. And so they just aren't aware.
So you would say the Mormon religion keeps them so busy that they don't have time to look at what they believe.
Yeah. Actually, there was prophets that actually said something to the effect, when they were asked hard questions, you can look at Joseph F. Smith. He was asked, he wrote books, and they asked him a really hard question he didn't have an answer for. And he goes, you have too much to worry about in doing what needs to be done than to worry about this question. That was his answer, okay? It is one of the things that they will kind of punt on.
Can I ask a quick one?
Oh, sure.
What if you pray to ask God if Joseph Smith's a prophet and you don't have the burning feeling or the...
Okay, I actually dealt with this on my mission. When somebody prays and they don't have a feeling, then the first thing that they're going to say is, well, maybe you weren't praying sincerely, or maybe you weren't praying with real intent. Or if you get the wrong answer, well, you know, obviously that's not the same answer that I got, so there's something wrong here. And so there must be something that you're doing, maybe some sin in your life. That's the first thing that they usually will go to.
How do you reconcile the fall of Adam and Eve being kicked out of the garden because they wanted to become like God, with the idea that at the end of your life you get to become a God?
Oh, boy, you don't know how difficult of a question that is for a Mormon, okay? Because a Mormon actually believes the fall is good. In the Book of Mormon, Adam fell that men might be and men are that they might have joy. It was a necessary thing. In fact, Mormons believe that there was two commandments given to Adam and Eve, and they were contradictory to each other. Multiply and replenish the earth, and then don't partake of the fruit. Well, if they don't partake of the fruit, they can't have kids. And so you have to partake of the fruit to have the kids. So they had to break one in order to keep the other. And so it was more important that they keep the procreate one than it was to keep the other one. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. Okay? And so from a Mormon perspective, it's really complicated. It's really hard to go there.
Yeah, I mean, when you're talking about having to keep all of the commandments, which mm-hmm. ones do you decide are more important to keep?
In that case, there was a commandment given by God that they were supposed to break.
I was just thinking about the whole issue of pride. When you were struggling to be perfect in all things, did that ever occur to you that if you became perfect, that you would also become very prideful in your own mind?
I had a different understanding of what pride was as a Mormon. Okay, pride as a Mormon was boasting about the good things that I was doing, you know, telling somebody how good I am. Mm-hmm. Pride really is more than that. Pride has to do with saying I deserve to be forgiven because of the things that I have done. That is pride. Okay, it's a sense of I deserve a payment. Basically, it's like a business relationship with God. Humility has to do with realizing that I can't be good enough, and so therefore I need Christ. Okay, and so it's an actual reality check. Okay, and it takes you have to be broken in order to get to that point. You have to realize that you can't be good enough before you can get to the humility part, and that's what God did with me. He showed me that I could not be perfect. And brought me to a relationship with his son.
But how does that affect all other Mormons who are still struggling day after day with trying to be perfect so they can attain to this
That is Godship. The same sort of thing that I want Mormons to consider, okay? This is the question that can bring them out of Mormonism, but it may not. I mean, if we look at the Pharisee versus mm-hmm. the tax collector, the Pharisee was not forgiven. And he wasn't doing anything wrong. In fact, he had a list of good things that he was doing. And that scripture never made sense to me. The Pharisee deserved forgiveness. The tax collector, he didn't. Okay? But the tax collector was forgiven. And the Pharisee wasn't. And until a Mormon can realize, and actually there's a verse I want to share with you. This is Romans 10, verses 1 through 3. Brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites and for the Mormons is that they might be saved. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God. But their zeal is not based on knowledge, since they did not know the righteousness that comes from God and sought to establish their own righteousness, they did not submit to God's righteousness. Mm-hmm. See, as soon as I try to use my righteousness as a way in with God, I can't submit to the righteousness that comes from God, and it keeps me out. I had to give up two things when I became a Christian. I had to give up my personal righteousness, and I also had to give up my sin. Those are two things that I had to give up so that I could receive the righteousness that comes from God. I gave up glory or godhood so that I could have security in Christ. Outer darkness is hell. The whole thing is. Outer darkness is permanent hell.
I got a question, kind of a lifelong question. My parents divorced when I was about 8, and my dad's first cousin, who you probably know, who is a bishop in Cottonwood, I lived in Camp Verde.
Okay.
Came and got my brother and I, and for about a month or so, took us to Mormon church. We were baptized in the Mormon church, then never came again. Is there something for baptizing people, and then once they're baptized, they're in, or what?
Well, from a Mormon perspective, that's just the start of the path. I mean, there's still a lot of things that you would have to do in order to be able to make it from a Mormon perspective. You still have to go through the temple, and you still have to live all the commandments. Otherwise, you won't make it into the celestial kingdom. But Christ is a lot easier than that.
Yeah, but I just never could understand why he just, once we were baptized, he never came back. Never took us again, or
I can't really understand like that request. Other than maybe he had pressure from family members to make sure that you guys were baptized. And if he was a bishop, you know, it may look bad that, you know, he has family members that are not members of the church. I mean, at least need to get you in. If nothing else, you could be Jack Mormons.
I have a question kind of right
over here. Okay.
Tagged right onto that. I had a family member tell me that we are probably baptized into the Mormon church because they baptize for the dead, and they also, can you explain that a little bit?
Well, that really can't happen until you're dead, okay? you have to die first. And, you know, so if you're not a member of the church, you have to be dead at least for a year, and then if I am related to you, I can submit your name to the temple for the work to be done. And then I could have the work done for you. But as long as you're alive, you have an opportunity to accept the gospel, so they're going to wait until you're dead. Well, boy, complicated question. Okay, Mormons, it doesn't really show this on this sheet right here. There's a waiting place before Judgment Day. This is actually showing what happens at Judgment Day, okay? But in Mormonism, there's spirit prison and spirit paradise. They call it the spirit world, and it's a waiting place. For everyone that's going to the celestial kingdom, they go to spirit paradise. For all the lower kingdoms and outer darkness people, they go to spirit prison. Now, for those that never heard the gospel and never had an opportunity to accept it in this life, there are people that come from the spirit paradise and will preach the gospel to you. And if you meet those conditions, then you can accept the work done for you in the temple, and then you would move from spirit prison to spirit paradise. But the caveat is you have to have never heard the gospel. Now, for you that's been baptized in the church, they're going to say, too late for you. Now, for you that they might say that the missionaries came and knocked on your door in this life, okay, and that was your opportunity. Okay, and you didn't take it. And so Mormonism is really clear. Either you do it in this life, if you have the opportunity, or you don't get in.
How many Mormons do you think have this deep feeling of trying to do right and wanting to do right and knowing that they're not and are seeking so hard to find the right way?
I would say that's probably the majority. Of people in the church. And the way that I can tell you this, probably the best way I could tell you this, in Provo, it's 98% Mormon, okay? And they have kind of a nickname for Provo. They call it Happy Valley, okay? Now, the reason why they call it Happy Valley is because 60% of the Mormons there are on Prozac, okay? Well, there's a reason for that. They're depressed. They're not living up to all the standards that they have to. And so, you know, it is a heavy burden. You know, these things are weighty material. Mormons have one of the highest suicide rates in the country, okay, especially among teenagers. I had a friend of mine when I was growing up that killed himself, you know, and I don't know if it was related specifically to this, but I can understand why he would go there. You know, I was that close to doing it myself. You know, because it was my last chance to hold on to my righteousness, my last final act of righteousness to hopefully let me into the celestial kingdom. In Mormonism, is there a judgment seat? Absolutely. Oh, the judgment seat in Mormonism, that's actually more complicated than, for us as Christians, it's Jesus Christ and that's it, okay? In Mormonism, each prophet and each bishop and each stake president stands as a judge in Israel. And so as a Mormon, I would have to go through the judges of Israel in order to make it into the celestial kingdom. That would be my bishops and my stake presidents and finally Jesus before I'd be able to enter in to the celestial kingdom.
What religious background did Joseph Smith have?
That's a great question. What was Joseph Smith's religious background? Joseph Smith was an occultist. Okay, Mormons are not aware of this. This is something that's very hard for a Mormon to hear. Okay, an occultist is someone that believes in Jesus Christ. They believe in God the Father and the Holy Ghost, but they believe that magic and mysticism is the true way to communicate and interact with God through astrology, through divination, through seer stones. Joseph Smith's background was from the occult world. His family was raised in the occult. His great-great-grandfather was raised in the occult. It was passed down from generation to generation. It's fascinating because when you start looking at the occult, they believe that the Bible is corrupt. Why? Because magic is not in the Bible. In fact, the Bible teaches against magic. And so they say that someone along the way corrupted the Bible. And so it's not too far for Joseph Smith to say, the Bible is corrupt, because he was taught all his life that it was corrupt.
So how old was he when he got this revelation to be this charismatic cult leader?
Oh boy, that's another really good question. It depends on what history you're looking at. The official church position is he was 14 when he had his first vision. I don't believe in the first vision. I don't believe that it ever occurred. And I could tell you reasons why I don't believe it occurred, because he changed the nature of God over the lifetime of Mormonism. From when he started it to the end of Mormonism, the nature of God changed. Now, for someone that speaks and talks with God, they're not going to change their nature of God. They're going to know what it is. And so I don't believe in the first vision. Now, I do believe in the encounter that he had with Moroni. I don't believe it was an angel from God. I believe it was an angel from the devil, okay? And I believe that that occurred at 17, not at 14. But the Mormon Church will point back to the 14-year-old experience. Are there secret ceremonies? Yes, there are. I will say this, okay? If you talk about the secret ceremonies that are done in the temple, you're going to offend a Mormon right away, okay? Those are one of the things that I say stay away from. It's not important, okay? They won't call it secret. They will call it sacred, okay? I think Mormons have a weird understanding of what the difference is between sacred and secret. They've kind of intertwined those. Not too far off from the cult world. The cult world also believes that what's sacred is secret. But that's another story in itself. But yes, the temple ceremonies, everything that you do in there, you're never supposed to reveal to anyone because it's sacred, and it's something that they believe that if you were to do that, that would be breaking your covenants that you made in the temple. They do teach that Jesus was married and had children. In fact, if he's to become a god, he has to be married. Okay, and so, of course, and they say the two Marys and Martha were his wives. Now, most Mormons are unaware a lot about that. That's one of those early document things. You can go and look at the early prophets' teachings, Brigham Young, Orson Pratt, all of these early prophets and apostles, and they will say that Jesus had was married and had more than one wife.
What does Mormonism teach about the end times, the rapture, tribulation?
What does Mormonism teach about end times, the rapture, and tribulation? They don't really teach a whole lot about that. I had a whole different worldview when it came to what happens at the end of the world. Okay, in Mormonism, all the priesthood will be gathered together at Adam on Diamond, which is a place in Missouri. It's actually right outside the place where the Garden of Eden was, according to Mormonism. There would be, some things that would happen in Jerusalem, but most of the things, the temples that were going to be built in the New Jerusalem, was going to be in Independence, Missouri. And so there's a lot of things that Mormons believe because of revelation that are entirely different than what the Bible teaches about that. And so, right here, okay.
We live across from the Mormon church, and every school morning, the children, they appear to be high school age children, are going to, I assume, classes for their missionary work. Is that correct? And then this last week, I went to pick my grandson up at the airport, and I was surrounded by Mormons. They were waiting for the new recruits that had just been indoctrinated in Salt Lake City. So how soon did they start these children for their missionary work?
All right. Kind of an interesting question there. Not really understanding Mormon culture. Seminary is what they do across the street from the high school, okay? And that's just for kids, and they aren't necessarily preparing for mission at that place. Now, I was paying attention on my, when I was in seminary, so that I would be ready to answer questions when I went out on my mission. But really, it's about indoctrination. It's about teaching the Mormons what they believe, what they come from. And actually, I would love for Christians to do the same thing. If Christians took the time to figure out where the schools are going to be built, and if they built their own building right across the way, and we had our pastors come teaching the kids, they would be able to be released and be able to do that too. This is America. We can do that sort of stuff. It's just the Mormons are taking advantage of it. We're not. Now, as far as the airport goes, I would assume that probably what you were doing is you were on a day when the missionaries were sent down from Provo to the mission in Tempe. And so they all put them on a plane, and then the mission president picks them up at the airport and then drives them to the mission and sends them off to their areas.
Could you tell me where women fit into the celestial kingdom, if they do?
Okay, women are goddesses, men are gods, and they have different functions. The women would be bearing children and raising children, taking care of the kids. That's their job. And forever, yes, that's what they do. And the men would be preparing planets and doing all the hard work, so to speak, having places for them to go so that they can become gods and of their own worlds someday.
Are you persecuted for what you're doing, or do you have a lot of Mormons coming to you for clarification?
I wish I could say that my Mormon friends that I had remained friends. And I wish I could say that my family relationships were the same as what they were when I left Mormonism, but they're not. I have a strained relationship with my in-laws and a strained relationship with my own parents. They all think that what I'm doing here is the worst thing I could possibly do. My friends, or I thought were friends, they just evaporated once they learned that I left the church. It was more important that I was a member of the church first than it was for us to have a friendship.
Back here. Another contradiction that I've heard of before is that if everybody has kids so that they can have them on their eternal planet, but then nobody is in their parents' eternal planet, then there's just a contradiction there.
Yeah, how can families be together forever if everybody's got their own planets? Okay, good question. It's a problem that most Mormons really haven't thought about. I think what most Mormons will say is that we can have family get-togethers, like a barbecue, and do a sort of thing like that. That's probably the best answer that you can receive. I'm going to make it even worse for you, okay? Heavenly Father, according to Mormonism, has had billions of spirit babies, each one of us, okay? If God, who is in Mormonism, has a body, and he's stuck in one place at one time, then that means that he can only spend like a billionth of a second with each one of his kids. Okay? Now, that's not quality time, and that is not anything that I would want. Okay? I mean, essentially, that means I have no time with God. If I got a billionth of a second, I can't even recognize that I've missed it. That's the problem with Mormonism. It's a man stuck in time and space. Now, the God of the Bible, okay, who is outside of time and space, who fills the universe, who can be everywhere at the same time, can spend quality time with you while he's spending quality time with me at the same time. And so he could do that for eternity with billions of kids. That is a true God that has power. Not the limited God of Mormonism that is a man that can only be with one billionth of a second of with its kids. Oh, over here.
Okay, we're taught in the Bible that if we believe in Christ and we've accepted him as our Savior, that we're going to heaven, but that works can't get us there. Do Mormons believe that once they accept Christ that they're going to heaven, but they also have to do works?
I wish it was that way. Mormons believe that it's kind of a step along the process. I have to be baptized, I have to receive the gifts of the Holy Ghost, and so they would say that that would be me accepting Christ, but that's just one step among a bunch of steps that I have to do in order for me to finally know if I've truly been forgiven. And so it's not, there's never a point in which you really have that security like we have.
What about babies that die or people who are mentally incapacitated and cannot make a choice?
Okay, babies that die or mentally incapacitated people that cannot make a choice. That's a really good question. Mormons have already answered that question. They're taught that if they die before the age of accountability or they are not reasonable enough, and the age of accountability in Mormonism is 8 years old, that they go straight to the celestial kingdom. So all they had to do was come here, receive a body, and then they're in. Okay. Now, for me, as a Mormon, I was really jealous, okay, of people like that, because I have to work really hard trying to get there, and those guys just got in, okay? And so it made me really jealous for them.
What is the Mormon Church's position on marriage outside the faith? And then also a couple that was married in the Mormon Church, but one has left the church and the other did not.
Okay. Good questions. Mormons are discouraged from marrying outside the church because I can't take you through the temple if you're not a worthy member. And so that means that we won't be able to make it to the celestial kingdom if I was to marry you. So they discourage that. For those that are husband and wife, say, and they're both Mormons, they got sealed in the temple, one of them leaves and one of them stays in the church. It's oftentimes that they are encouraged to get a divorce, okay, that the husband or wife to leave whoever is left the church because they need to find somebody that can take them to the celestial kingdom. And actually, it's a really great strategy if you think of it from the devil's perspective. Isolate the person that is leaving the church so that nobody else leaves the church, okay, and then I keep them going where I want them to.
Yeah, Jesus Christ was the one of the many spiritual babies who was chosen to come to earth for a special purpose. Mm-hmm. Was that special purpose in the Mormons' mind to die for our sin problem? And then what do they do with that?
Yes, the Mormon Jesus did die for our sin problem, okay? He was chosen to do that. But I have to qualify for that grace. That means if I don't keep all the commandments, and do everything that I'm supposed to do, then I can't get the grace. Remember, it's after everything that I can do, and perfection is required. And so if I'm going to get that forgiveness that comes from Christ, then I have to be worthy of it. And the best way I could probably describe it is Jesus will pay for my sins, all of my past sins, as long as I walk from this moment perfect forward. Okay? And so that's the weight that Mormons are carrying.
We're really out of time. Here's the good news. Andy's not running off. Are you?
No.
Okay. Afterwards, and that really was part of our plan, was to have a reception and have him available to you. I think we've had a wonderful time of questions. I had two I wanted to throw out to you that I think might be interesting to our folks. One of them leads to the other. The book Under the Banner of Heaven. Have you read it, and do you feel it's legitimate if you have? That's the first question.
The first question is I actually haven't read that book.
Okay.
Though I have heard about it, it seems legitimate, but it's writing from the perspective of fundamentalists, you know, and what they were doing.
And that's my second question. Mm-hmm. We see a lot in the news, Warren Jeffs, mm-hmm. For example, of what is happening. Maybe just dialogue for a few moments about the differences between, because there's some confusion maybe with folks
right.
about Mormonism and the other group.
Yeah, there are 165 different sects of Mormonism, okay? Each of them claims to have their own true prophet, and each of them claims to be the only true church. Warren Jeffs is just a small splinter group off of the mainstream church that I grew up in, which is out of Salt Lake City. The Salt Lake City Church does not believe in polygamy. They believe that it's wrong, hence the reason why I was disfellowshipped, okay? There are groups of Mormons that have left the mainstream church claim to practice polygamy and that they have a direct authority from God to do so. Warren Jeffs is one of those, and Warren Jeffs, fortunately, was put in life in prison just last week, which I'm very grateful for after learning what he was doing.